today, we're going to have like a little homework for you. If you have your programs in your hand, if you have a program, just kind of, you know, wave your program or whatever. Make sure if you do not have a program, make sure that you get one before we leave, okay? And the reason for that is, and I'll tell you in a little bit, I was really like looking at some different videos about being successful. And one of the things, my favorite things to do, as many of you know, is listen to Dave Ramsey, because he's always talking about being debt-free and becoming a millionaire and just various things along those lines. But what he teaches, and this is what's so good, his principles are how God would want you to use his money. So he's just not grabbing stuff out of the air publicly or whatever. He is giving you God's perspective and how you ought to handle your money. So today we want to talk about disciplining yourself for success. The first verse, or the first two verses that we are going to use, is from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 and 25. And it said, "Do you not know that in a race all runners run, but only one received the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control." Self-control or discipline can be interchanged in that particular verse. "Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath. But we, as believers, we do it to receive one that is imperishable, one that will not spoil." Let us pray. God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for these, your people that are in this place today. God, those who have just listened to your voice and just decided to come out to a church house, to just gather together to see what it is that you might have to say. You might want to direct in their lives. And we just pray, oh Heavenly Father, that you know, while we speak, that they'll not hear my voice, but they'll hear your voice, the voice of the Holy Spirit, that they will carry with them day in and day out. In Jesus' name we do pray, amen. We as Americans are a nation of hedonists. You say, what's a hedonist? A hedonist is a pleasure-seeking person. A person to where pleasure is the most important thing in his life. In America, and you hear so often said, if it feels good, do it. If it does not feel good, then we need to avoid it. We're only interested in what is fun in life. If it's not fun, just forget all about it. I don't want to do it. Anything that is unpleasant should be avoided at all costs. We do not like good old-fashioned discipline. We don't like discipline. We don't like to discipline ourselves. But I want you to know that we're going to look at the Bible today and see what the Bible says about personal discipline, because personal discipline is the one thing that will lead you to a successful life. And if you're going to have a successful life, you must be disciplined in six areas that I'm going to give you today. And now what I want you to do with your program is to take your program, and as I list them, I want you to check them off, give yourself a grade anywhere from 1 to 10 and how you stack up in that particular area. Grade yourself, and then all next week you have something to work on. So that's why it's so important to, first of all, have a program, to have the items in your hand. You don't have to write them. So I say thank you to Sister Ellery, Sister Tremaine for tolerating me in my late night hours and all, and to make sure that we have this for our use. But the first one is this: I must master my moods. I must master my moods. If I'm going to be a successful person, I must master my moods. Proverbs 25:28 says this: a person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls, no protection at all. Here's the question on the flow: are you a moody person? How do you answer that? Well, I'm going to say this. Ask somebody around you later on, okay? Not now. Do you live by emotions in life? What percent of the decisions that you make are made because I feel like it? I feel like it, so I did it. I didn't feel like it, so I didn't in life. Do you ever not feel like doing some things and have to do them anyway? Of course we do. But I want you to understand this. You'll never become successful only doing the things that you feel like doing. You're going to have to do some things that you do not feel like doing in life. You got to understand that. Most of the accomplishments in this world were done by people who did things that did not feel like doing them. And I know most of the time we'll tell each other certain things. It's like choose a career. If you choose a career, you'll never feel like you worked in a day. Listen, that's difficult. I don't care what you say about it. Even though from time to time I like what I do as a pastor and a preacher and all, it's hard sometimes. And sometimes I don't want to do it. But I have to master my moves and show up over here anyhow. Now, Proverbs 25:28 says this. It says, a person with no self-control is defenseless. You let your guard down when you're not don't exercise self-control. Without discipline or without a discipline concerning your moods, you're a person who are at the mercy of moods. You're at the mercy of whatever whim that you feel like on this day or that day or not. You're at the mercy of I feel like it or I don't feel like it in life. You are actually a helpless victim because you're letting your moods dictate what it is that you do. Now listen, if you ever think about being saved, you will not feel like you're saved every day of your life. So being saved is not a matter of how I feel. It's a matter of God's word, the work of Christ, and the work of the Holy Spirit in me as well. So first of all, if I'm going to be successful in life, I got to master my mood. Second is simply this. I must watch my words. Now, I just happened to notice in our Sunday school lesson this morning that the Messiah, the writer, Isaiah, whatever, he says, my words or my mouth is like a sharp sword. Now, listen, that was for him. That ain't for you. Do you have a sharp sword tongue in your mouth? Listen, Proverbs 13:3 says this. Those who guard their lips guard their life. But he who speaks rashly comes to ruin in life. You open your mouth and let me just move on. But here's the next verse. James 1:26 says this. If you claim to be religious but do not control your tongue, you're fooling yourself. And your religion is worthless. Now what that simply says is a break it down manner. Everybody around you in your house, they know you went to church today. And so when you come home, you ought to have a certain type of behavior. Because listen, if you're going to go home with sharp words and in a bad mood, you wasted your time. Simply speaking, that's what the writer is saying. Your religion is worthless. That's saying if I profess to be a believer or a Christian in life, I must pick and choose the words that I'm going to use and the moods that I'm going to be in life. The psalmist in Psalm 141:1 simply says this, and it was basically like he was asking God. He said this, set a guard over my mouth. That's, you know, a guard is like an armed sentinel, a person with a weapon to say, if you say it, I'm going to, you know. Set a guard over my mouth and keep watch over the doors of my lips. Because we say stuff. Listen, one writer put it like this, words are like bullets. They come out and you cannot control the damage that they will do. Words are like bullets and our mouth is the gun. You pull the trigger and there's no taking it back. The wound might heal, but every time a wound heals, it'll leave a scar behind. Am I right? Words have power and we have to know that. So understand this. Your words can either be seeds or they can be bullets in life. And you have to understand. And we all from time to time will lash out with very hurtful words in our life. They explode out of our mouth. They're uncontrollable, uncontainable, if we'll say it like that. And we don't care where they land, nor how deep they penetrate in life. Watch your words as well. Words are like bullets. When you speak harshly to somebody or even about somebody, those are bullets. When you criticize people, and typically when we criticize, we do it face to face. When you criticize a person deeply, then that's a bullet. When you spread lies about a person, that's a bullet as well that came out of your mouth. And listen, and when hurt leaves our body, we're considered to be living cemeteries all around us. We sow graveyards everywhere we go by our mouth. And I want you to think about this. But it can be seeds. Words can be seeds. When you speak in love, when you encourage people, or you give grace. Grace is when somebody has said something to me and I don't like it, I'm going to give you grace today because I'm mastering my words, so I'm not going to fight back as well in my life. When we nurture the relationship that we have, is it somebody in your life, a spouse or a child or people you go to church with, you know, you have to nurture those relationships because that's like family as well. When we do that, we grow as people in our life. We become more successful in life as well. And if we do that, you will eventually see a good crop of seeds all around you. And you'll become encouraged as well. So if I'm going to be successful, if I'm going to discipline myself to be successful, I got to master my moods, I got to watch my words, and I must restrain my reaction. Proverbs 19 and 11 says this: sensible people control their temper. They earn respect by overlooking wrong in life. It was George Washington Carver who said this: I will never allow another man or woman to control my life by making me hate him. Not doing that. You know? Anytime you make the phrase, you're making me mad, what you're admitting is that person is in control over you in your life. They control your attitude. They control the way you feel. And if you're angry because of them, then they are controlling you. And we don't let other people control. You don't want people to control. That's what you're fighting about in the first place. But when you're angry, you have just let them control you in this life. Isn't it amazing how children learn that at a very early age in their life? They think, I may be too small, I may not be as powerful as you, but if I can make my mommy and daddy mad, I'm in control. And that's what they do. They'll get down on the floor in a grocery store, a drugstore, and just kick and scream all over the floor. They're trying to control you as well in their life. But a disciplined person will restrain his reaction in life. 2 Timothy 4 and 5, Paul teaches Timothy. Timothy is young, and Paul is his mentor. And Timothy is a young pastor. And Paul writes to him in chapter 4, verse 5, simply saying this: keep your head in all situations. Because he know as a young pastor, you're going to be tried time and time again in life. But keep your head in all situations. Now I want to say that to parents. Keep your head in all situations. I want to say that to all husbands, all wives. Keep your head in all situations in life. He's saying disciplined people choose to act rather than react in life. Disciplined people are not controlled by circumstances, things you say and things you do. Proverbs 16:32 says this, and this is a good news Bible: it is better to be patient than powerful. It is better to win control over yourself than over a whole city. I got control over me. If I have control over me, I have control over any and everything else around me in life, because I just have to control me. So I control how I think, I control what it is I see or how I interpret what it is I see. And I can decide that I want to interpret it as being something good in my life. Here's the fourth one. Okay, first, I'm going to discipline myself to be successful. I got to master my moods. I got to watch my words. And I got to restrain my reactions. Are you giving yourself a grade? Okay, number four, I'm going to stick to my schedule. I'm going to stick to my schedule. Now, for some of you, you're going to have to develop a schedule, because you ain't got a schedule. So the idea here is have a schedule, okay? Assuming you have a schedule, which you should have, because Ephesians 5, 15 and 16 says this: live life with a due sense of responsibility. Make the best use of your time. The only way you can make the best use of your time is a schedule. I did something, I think it was Tuesday. I forgot about board meeting. That's on my schedule. Before the pandemic, I had reminders everywhere, popping up all over the place, all during the day, reminding me of board meeting. We go through the pandemic, and we go through a year and a half or two with no board meeting. I wiped out all my reminders. And so Sunday, standing right here, I talked to Wanda, and we talked about having board meeting on Tuesday. Tuesday came, and board meeting is at 6 o'clock, and my phone rang at 20 minutes after 6. And it said, "Where you at?" I said, "Oh, I'm studying my Bible study for the bar. You're supposed to be at the church." I forgot. Just like that. This is my point. Your life must be controlled by schedules, and schedules should put things in place with reminders that these things have to occur. Now, medical people have figured that out. How many of you get constant calls from your doctor telling you that you got an appointment? You have an appointment Tuesday. Then Monday they'll call, you have an appointment Tuesday. They just keep reminding you have an appointment. Now, you think that's for you? No, that's for them, because they want your money. And that is the idea. And they'll tell you, they go through these efforts of like, we got to get you. If they don't get you in the office, they can't pay the light bill at the office. It's a schedule that they keep, and it's established by reminders. That is the idea. Listen, we all have the same amount of time in a week. We all have 168 hours. And here's a question. Why are some people more productive than the rest of us? Why are they? Why do some people get more done than other people? And we all got the same amount of time. It's because of discipline. It's because of scheduling, personal discipline, sticking to a schedule. Set a schedule and stick to it. Let me tell you something about how you do well to manage your time in life, and this is very important takeaway today. There are three important facts about life. To be successful, it's going to take time. You are not going to wake up tomorrow on top of the world. It's going to take time. It's a process. It's like the old credit repair situation in life. You got there by messing up your credit over a period of years. You are not going to call the phone number 1-800 and fix your credit in a matter of a few weeks. It takes time. That is the point in life. Whatever it is you're going to do in life, a career or whatever, get accustomed to a new life. It takes time. The second one is this: you don't have time for everything. You need to select the things that have priority and do those things and do them first. And you need to be able to tell some other people, "I don't have time for that." And the reason I say that is for number three, because if you don't decide how you're going to use your time, other people will. They'll give you something to do. "What you doing today?" "Oh, I ain't doing nothing." "Hey, how about this?" You know? You don't have something to do. More often than not, I can think of the times when somebody has called me and said, "What are you doing?" And I'm going like, "Oh, I'm busy doing this." They go, "Okay, I'll find somebody else." You know what they're looking for? Somebody ain't doing nothing. That's what they're looking for as well. So you got to get a schedule and stick to your schedule in order to increase your successfulness in life. Here's the fifth one. The fifth one is this: I must manage my money. I can't even begin to tell you how important that is in life. Grade yourself. I want to, like, time out. Go ahead, give yourself a grade. All right, right there. How do you manage your money? Okay, listen, here's the verse. Proverbs 21:20 says this: "For the wise man saves for the future, but the foolish man spends whatever he gets." You know what they call that? That's paycheck to paycheck. That's right. But anyway, how smart are you? How smart am I in life? Is if we learn to live on a margin. And what is a margin? A margin is just a small amount of money. You know what a budget is? A budget is when you tell your money where to go. And now, if you don't have a budget, all you do is look down and see where your money went. But the proper way to manage your money is to tell it where to go. And you'll find that out. Now listen at this. This is a sad note. The average American saves 4% of their income. The average European saves 16% of their income. And the average Japanese saves 25% of their income. Why are we so bad at saving in America? I was listening at a Dave Ramsey the other day, and a lady was calling up, and they were debt-free, and they had come from one of the island countries, her and her husband as well, and they had finally gotten themselves debt-free. And this was her testimony. So we came to America. We were offered all kind of plastic. And we were offered cards here, cards, store cards, bank cards, all these different cards. And we thought the American way was to get a bunch of cards. And that's exactly what they started doing, was getting all these cards. And then after a few years, they realized, oh, my God, we're in trouble with all these cards as well. And the reason why Americans do cards is because we have to live now. We need it now. I want it now. And even if I have to charge it, I want it now. I'm going to live by whatever means I want to, even if it requires a credit card in life. The survey goes on to say for every $1,000 that an American makes, we spend $1,300. You know what that's saying? That's saying you're living by deficit spending. Deficit spending. And what you're doing is you're imitating the government. And the only problem with that is the government, they make money. And they can get away with it. So when they need some more money, they just make some more money. I heard somebody ask this question the other day, and I share the sentiments exactly. Where are we getting all that money we sent into Ukraine? Huh? Where are we getting it from? Because from what I've always heard is that we are how many $1 trillion in deficit. So all of a sudden it's like, how many billion over there? Let's give this many billion in stimulus back. Let's do a highway project. We just spend money. We don't have no money, but we just spend it. It's called deficit spending. You know, don't imitate the government. That's what that point means, really. You need to learn to manage your money. The problem we have as Americans is lax discipline or impulse buying. I see it, and I gotta have it. When the going get tough, the tough go shopping. Yeah, that's you. I like it. I got to have it. We don't buy things we need. We just buy things we want just because of an impulse in our life as well. Now, this is a very important question. How disciplined are you with your money? This is going to help. Dave Ramsey again. Now, to make you understand how people can accumulate money, he lists the top five careers of people who are millionaires. Okay? Number one is an engineer, an accountant, then a school teacher is number three. Now, management, person in management, and an attorney. Now, what blew my mind was a school teacher. Now, because of what I'm saying, it's simply this. We typically think that's not a very good paying career. But it's in the top five careers of people who become millionaires. And the reason for that is because they're educated to the point of where they understand how to manage their money. That is the idea. So you might be saying to yourself, I don't want to be no school teacher. You want to be a millionaire? You can be a school teacher. That is the idea as well. Listen, only 15% of the millionaires were on a career path such as a vice president or a CEO. A small quantity of people like that. I know that most of you have probably listened at the news here lately and heard that one of the latest accomplishments of LeBron James. LeBron James has now been declared by Forbes magazine to be a billionaire. But he was with a group of his friends, and they wanted to know, who is the cheapest NBA player you know? They all say, Bron. And he started laughing. But he is considered by his friends the cheapest NBA billionaire that they knew. And the reason for that, and then LeBron chimes in and say this, is because I won't buy no apps for my iPhone. Now, Bron got a billion dollars, but he would not spend a nickel on an app. They say, Bron, how do you listen to music? I got Pandora with commercials. He said, I will not buy Spotify or Pandora without the commercials in it. That's not how I'm spending my $1 billion. Now watch this. How many of y'all got Pandora and Spotify subscriptions this morning? Think about that. How many of y'all are just about moneyed out because you got all these streaming things on the television as well? Do you know you could get probably 40 channels with an antenna stuck up on the wall? Do you know that? You try it sometime. Well, I'll tell you what, go in my office in there, because I got one, okay? Now, money. We're talking money because this is where we're at. A study by Fidelity Investments found out that 88% of the millionaires in America are self-made. That means they did not inherit the money to become it. 88%. So that means you have the potential to do that as well in your life. So here's the how do you become a millionaire. And first of all, you don't need a six-figure income in order to become a millionaire. And that's very important, because some people think if I made more, I could save more. You don't need a six-figure income, or you don't need family money coming from inheritance. You need to become a saver. So the tip for becoming a millionaire is to start saving early in your life and repeat it over and over and over again in your life. Take advantage of what is called compounding interest in life. Number two, if I'm going to become a millionaire, I'm going to avoid unnecessary spending and debt. Debt. If I ask you a question, what kind of car does the average millionaire drive? What kind of car? I know you're thinking Jaguar, Bentley, Mercedes-Benz, Lexus, or whatever. The average wealthy person, no, 61% of all the people with money, we're talking millionaires now, drive Hondas, Toyotas, and Ford. You better let that BMW dream, you better let that rest, okay? Because what you're doing is you are choosing the opportunity. You're choosing to make it far more difficult in managing your money. You ain't got to have a BMW, okay? And here's the last one, and I'm going to wrap. I must maintain my health, because that's exceptionally important. 1 Thessalonians 4:4 said this: each of you should learn to control your own body, keeping it pure and treating it with respect. I got a question. Do you treat your body with respect? Do you realize that as Americans, we need more exercise and more rest and fewer calories? And most of you are thinking, what are we going to eat when we leave here? Won't he hurry up so we can go eat? Proverbs 23:2 says this: if you have a big appetite, this is Bible talk. If you have a big appetite, restrain yourself. Now, that's a really polite way of saying it. Is that right? If you have a big appetite, restrain yourself. But guess what the King James text said? If you are given to gluttony, put a knife to your throat. That's what the Bible says. I didn't make that up. I looked in 7 or 8 different translations, and it says this: if you can't control your appetite, you need to put a knife to your throat. Because you're killing yourself anyway. It's just that you choosing how. You know what the definition of a dieter is? A person who realized that what's on the table will soon be on the seat. Do you realize that most of the disease and things that we deal with in life, and things like arthritis and cancer and all these diabetes and things like that, these are diet issues that we have in our life? And you know what? You'll listen at people say this, and we'll get fixated with this thought, is that African Americans are prone to a certain disease or something, high blood pressure or diabetes or whatever, and we think it's based on the color of our skin. No, it's based on the diet that you have. So you can stop and control what it is you eat for your health. You know, bad diets are more responsible for more death than smoking. Now, everybody in here will believe that smoking will cause problems in your life. But do you realize food is worse based on statistics as well as life? Now, I'm through, and I just want to ask you a couple of questions here as we begin to close. Where do you need to develop more self-control? I've given you 6 points of interest. Where do you need to be disciplined? Where do you need to begin? How about one like Bible reading? How about like maybe coming to Sunday school, Bible study? How about memorizing scripture? How about tithing? That's just giving. Which area in your life do you need to work on that you need God to help you with? Do you need to say, Lord, master my moods. Help me master my moods, because I'm living by my feelings. I find myself flying off the hook more often than I think I should be. Help me to watch my words. I got a temper and I know it. Would you say that this morning? I need to learn to restrain my reactions. I need self-control in life. God, help me stick to my schedule. God, help me make a schedule. How about that? And then stick to it. God, give me insight. Put people around me. Ask the pastor, where is Dave Ramsey's station? How do I get that? Because I'm very undisciplined in my spending. God, help me maintain my health. Now, willpower is not enough. Self-control comes for when you let God have control in your life. Stand up with me as well, if you will. We have so many self-defeating habits in our life. Let us think about I surrender all, I surrender all.
I need you. You need